So hello, I'm Mark Ragan. I'm the managing director of BETC, and I want to welcome you all to the very first webinar for the very first show that is opening 9 days today. Well, at least the preview is 9 days, and opening night is on the 27th. So I'm going to take us right away to Jessica Robblee, who is the artistic director of the Boulder Ensemble Theatre Company and the director of Coal Country. Jess, are you there?
I'm here. Can you see my face?
I can see your face, yes.
Okay, good. I'm here in Englewood's best kept secret, Garce Works Production Studios. It's, you would never know what this little gem is until you get inside. I'm going to take you on a quick tour. I'm sitting at the production table with stage manager. Say hi, Wessie.
Hello.
Hi, Wessie.
Wessie, as you can see back to the lobby, we've got multiple computers set up to play music for the actors. And right here behind me is...
Hi, I'm Diane, and I understudy the lovely Martha.
Yes, we're lucky to have Diane.
Oh, hey. Hi, Diane.
Hi, Mark.
And then, get ready, here comes the whole cast. We have kind of a green screen situation in the film production studio.
Oh, my God. Look.
Hi. So maybe we can start with Martha.
Hi, I'm Martha. I'm playing Dr. Judy Peterson.
There she is. Thank you. And next to her?
I'm Chris. I'm playing Gary Quarles.
I'm Jason. I'm playing Tommy.
Hi, I'm Anastasia. I'm playing Patty.
Hey, everybody. I'm Gajardo. I'm playing Roosevelt Lynch Jr.
Hi, I'm Simone. I'm playing the judge.
Hey, I'm Mark. I'm playing Stanley Stewart. Everybody knows me as Goose.
Hi, I'm Lindsay. I'm playing Mindy.
And we wanted to introduce you to our rugs. You might notice that there's a lot of green on the walls here, and we found it absolutely exhausting mentally and physically to be around. So we covered as much of it as we could with this curtain behind the actors, and then also multiple rugs, because the floor is green too. And you'll see, these are really expert. Look at all these marks on their rug that everyone's having trouble telling the difference between on all our patterned rugs. So we have a lot of that. And then we have a few characters in the show that we want to introduce you to. You might not, a lot of people won't know these names, but right here, this is this piece right here, because it's a wide stool, not a regular one, is called Chonk. So if you are told to move Chonk, that's Chonk. And if you are told to move Thonk, you have to move this box right here. It thonks.
Yeah.
And what we have, a little boxy. Little boxy. These are the heroes of the story here. And the benches don't get any names. So that's how that goes. They have angry eyebrows sometimes. We position them in those. So this is our world, and we're leaving tonight. So we're saying goodbye to our many rugs tonight. And we won't miss them, actually, at all. So we're going to the Dairy Arts Center tomorrow night. We're really pumped. And we're excited to meet Joe Jung in person. We're going to play his music over speakers yet again for rehearsal tonight, but we get to see him Saturday live music, and we're pumped. We're about to do a run of the show, so I hope you have a great webinar, and we wish you well. Hope to see you at the show.
Bye.
Thank you, Jess. Thank you, cast. Love you all.
Back to you, Mark.
Bye-bye. Well, that was fun. That is Garce Works. Garce is a gentleman I met doing a video promotion a couple years ago, or about a year ago, for the Belle of Amherst. And he's such a nice guy, and he let us use his studio for rehearsals in Englewood. And so that's why you see the green screen on the walls, because Garce is often shooting in the studio with a green screen. So I am now going to give you a short background on Coal Country, and then we're going to introduce you to our special guest, which is the musical director for Coal Country, Joe Jung, and more about him in a second. But I wanted to talk just briefly about Coal Country and how I came to discover Coal Country. I was in New York researching a play that I'm writing about the poet Edna St. Vincent Millay. Many of you probably know Millay. She lived in the 1890s, 1910s, 20s, died in the 50s. And she had started this very famous theater in the West Village called the Cherry Lane Theater. And so I went down there to visit it as part of my research. And that night was the last night of Coal Country. And there was one ticket left. And I went in, and Joe was on stage playing that night. Joe was the understudy for Steve Earle during its run, not only at the Cherry Lane, but in its initial run at the Public in New York. And I was just absolutely blown away by the production and the play itself, as you will be. It is poignant. It is eloquent. It is beautiful in every way. And it moved me so much that that night, as I left the theater, I saw the two playwrights. I knew they were the playwrights, the way they were standing, greeting everyone at the door. And I went up to Jessica Blank and Eric Jensen, and I said, I would really like to bring this to Colorado. At the time, I wasn't managing director of BETC. I was just an independent producer. And then she said, well, give me some time, Jessica did, and come back at me in a year or so. And that's what we did. And then Jessica said, yes, go ahead and do it. So I am very proud to say that we are the first company outside of New York to do a full run of Coal Country. And I am so proud that Joe Jung is participating. As I said, Joe was the understudy for Steve Earle, Steve Earle being the legendary singer-songwriter who wrote the music that accompanies the actors in Coal Country. Now, real briefly, Coal Country is about the 2010 mining explosion in the upper Big Branch mine in West Virginia that killed 29 people. And it's really a story about the survivors and the family members, the people that were shattered by this event. And I'm going to let Joe tell you, and this is, I'm going to introduce Joe with this first question. Well, first we're going to hear a song from Joe. And then the first question, Joe, so you can think about it, is what is verbatim theater? And can you explain what that is? But first we're going to hear Joe. He's going to perform a song. It's actually the first song you hear as you're seated in the theater. Joe comes out onto the stage alone and he plays this. It's John Henry. Take it away, Joe.
Sing about him all across the land. John Henry was a steam driving man, and he beat the steam drill down and then he died. Yeah, he beat the steam drill down and then he died. And it didn't change nothing, but heaven knows he tried. He was buried with his hammer by his side. He beat the steam drill down and John Henry. John Henry could have told you what that means. When the company brought in all the big machines. John Henry was a steel driving man. John Henry was a steel driving man. And he died in West Virginia with his hammer in his hand. Now they sing about him all across the land. John Henry was a steel driving man.
Thank you, Joe. That was beautiful. You know, I've never heard music perform so well over a webinar. thanks to your experience with sound and the internet.
I do my best. I brought up my fancy mic tonight.
So Joe is Joe's been on Broadway. He's an actor. He's a teacher. And as you can see, he's a musician. He plays the guitar and he plays the banjo and he has his own jug band. And just an amazing performer all around. And during Cold Country, he actually had to step in once for an actor who I believe was sick. So, Joe, I wanted you to explain what it means that Cold Country is verbatim theater. What does that mean? How was the play written?
Yeah, so verbatim theater, basically Jessica Blank and Eric Jensen and Steve all went down to West Virginia during the trial of Don Blankenship, who was the owner of the coal mine when it exploded. They went down during the trial because they'd been fascinated by this case, and they started taking notes. They started meeting people. They started going to people's houses and interviewing them, and they would sit for hours and interview these folks and record everything. And then they would get home and they would transcribe every word, word for word, everything. And through that, all these transcriptions, they came out with about, I think, 40 hours of tape of recordings. And through that, all these transcriptions, they read them with actors. They got together with people and just read them, and had people read the different characters that they were thinking about. All these different people, and then they kind of whittled it down to basically the characters that we see in this play, and then they went back and they did more interviews, and through that they created the play. And where most plays are just the playwright's words, 95% of the words in this show, I mean everything except for Steve's songs, are verbatim from the people that lived through all of this.
I think what makes that so intriguing to me is how beautiful the script is. It is so eloquent, and I shouldn't be surprised because I grew up in Chicago, and there was a guy in Chicago by the name of Studs Terkel who wrote oral histories. And what he did is he'd carry his tape recorder around. He did one on work called Working, in which he interviewed people about their jobs, everyone from a bus driver to a doorman in Manhattan. And you were blown away by the eloquence of everyday people. Wouldn't you say that's one of the gorgeous things about this, is how beautiful the words are that come from these miners?
Absolutely. And it's raw. I mean, these are people who needed to talk and needed someone to listen, even more importantly than talking, just needing people to really listen to them and hear what they had to say and hear what this story means and what these people meant to them, and the situation behind all of it, the knowledge that it was going to happen and that nobody would listen, or that they couldn't talk and they were afraid to talk because they were afraid to lose their jobs. And I mean, at a time now when the labor movement is ramping back up again, to hear people's stories about what they're actually going through, why people are fighting for rights and for safety and for loved ones and for their passions, it's extraordinary how these people were able to open up to strangers and release this story into the world.
Important. And I think that's a really, you know, I'm glad you used the word release, because not only do I feel their release through their words, this tremendous purging of their grief over the loss of their loved ones and their community, but also it was kind of cathartic for me in the audience, which is kind of hard to explain when you think about it. Why would it be cathartic? Why would I be crying? Why would I have goosebumps? Why would I be inspired? And I've thought about that, you know, as the producing director of this, the guy who brought it, I thought about that question a lot, because people will say to me, well, isn't it very sad? And I'll say, well, yeah, it's sad, but at the end of the day, I'm uplifted by it. And I think the thing that's uplifting it about it is its description of the human heart. You know, you have faith in our ability to feel. And that's what comes forth, that we as human beings share this one thing, whether we're in Manhattan or whether we're in the hollers of West Virginia. And Joe, I wanted to ask you, because I know this play was highly personal for you. Tell me what it meant for you, the play itself, and in performing it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, so I teach theater at Montclair State, and that's in New Jersey. And I'm always, I really believe, and I talk to my students about this. We have long conversations that what makes humans different than other species is the ability to tell stories. The need to tell stories, the need to communicate and gather and release a story into the world. Mixing with that is human sense of music, the heartbeat. We're born with it. We're born hearing sounds and responding to sounds. Music changes us. It resonates in our ears and changes us from the inside. So the blend of these, this most human thing, gathering around to tell and listen to a story with music, are these two things that make us human. I mean, at the most basic level.
I'm so glad you said that. Yeah.
On a personal level, I mean, my wife's from West Virginia, her family's from West Virginia. I've been going back and forth there for 20 years now. And everyone that I talk to, I've met coal miners. She has family members who were coal miners and union workers. Their stories have become part of my life. And so to be involved in this show is, it touches me to the core in, as an artist and as just a person who now has more and more experience in the holler and having a part of my life deeply rooted in West Virginia.
You know, Joe, you made a lot of friends with the folks that are portrayed. And by the way, these are real people. As we said, it's 95% verbatim theater. So they're real people. They live today. In fact, Joe, would you talk about what it was like when they came to New York to see Coal Country?
Yeah, so they came twice. They came once during the public run, three days before we got shut down due to the pandemic. But they came up on a Friday night and saw the show on a Saturday. The families, these people that heard their own words talking back. And they all came back at Cherry Lane. The public brought everyone back. They flew everyone up for a weekend in New York City. A lot of them had never been to New York before. And it was cathartic on a number of levels. Not only did they get to hear their words and hear their story and the stories of these other people that they know so well and had such a connection with, but to also see a New York audience listening to their stories and recognizing them as people, recognizing the story from people in New York, which seems in West Virginia like the farthest place in the world. And for New Yorkers, West Virginia seems like the farthest place in the world. Everyone thinks that they know about West Virginia or have these ideas, preconceived ideas of West Virginia. And you don't know until you hear these people. You don't know until you hear the stories. And so I think for the families to be able to not only hear their stories told back and kind of see the action on stage, but to see the connection that is made and the bridge that is formed with a New York crowd that could really, for the first time, probably recognize and see what people are going through, what coal miners.
What was it, Joe? Was it intimidating for you and the actors to know that the real people that you were portraying was right there 20 feet from you in the stage? And they, well, and I heard them crying and emoting during the performance.
I remember at the Cherry Lane, the Cherry Lane is much smaller. The public had audience on three sides. It was big theater, lots of space. That was incredibly moving because you could really pick out where the people were. You could see Goose kind of stepping up the stage, like stepping off. He had to, you know, take off for a scene or two and then come back down when like the big kind of final song came in. At the Cherry Lane, everybody was right in front. First four or five rows were just full of gold and blue West Virginia shirts and hats. Like, they make their presence known. And from the start, they were cheering along, cheering the songs. They were all Steve Earle fans, and he was right there. They were singing along to the Union songs. They were weeping during some of the more intimate moments. I remember I was backstage. I was always ready, like trying to like prepare in case a string broke or something. But I would come backstage, and there was a point where they walked off stage, and the actors just looked at me and they said, "That is the most intense thing I've ever felt, ever." They'd never experienced, and we'd never. And so, it was just extraordinary. It was deeply profound, and an honor to be able to be invested in that. And then after the show, to have a reception and hang out with these people and just chat, you know, and talk about fishing and talk about the holler and talk about their gardens and talk about what they had done in New York, you know. And it was a real honor all the time to see.
Joe, I'm wondering, as we sit here and talk, I listened to all the music you played. We did two house parties with Joe recently, and I thought we'd break it the conversation up with I'm gonna throw you on the spot because I'm hoping you could play this. I loved the piece you wrote for your wife.
Oh,
about your wife. Can you just pull that out? Do you remember? You don't need music. And sure. I wonder if you could write that, because your wife's from West Virginia. Yes, you have been influenced strongly by her and her relatives. It's such a beautiful song.
Oh, yeah.
And I wanted you to play that, and we'll go back to the conversation. In the meantime, I'm going to ask the folks attending the webinar to go ahead and hit the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. And if you have any questions at all for Joe, just type them out, and then we'll get to them after the interview is done. You want to play that, Joe?
Yeah,
give
sure.
us a short background on it.
Yeah, of course. So my wife and I met in Massachusetts at the Berkshire Theater Festival. And we started what was going to be a long distance relationship. we clicked right away over the summer. And then at the end of the summer, I was moving to New York. She was going back to school in North Carolina. And it was not really a question of like, oh, are we going to stay together? It was, I'll see you on this, you know, I'll see you for this. I'll come down for Thanksgiving. I can come down to, I'll meet you in West Virginia for Christmas. And we did 4 years apart. We did 4 years of distance. And then she moved up to New York. We lived together for a year, and then we got married the next year. I wrote this as in one of those times when, you know, you just can't do anything else, you know. Okay. We were at a distance, and this is something that kind of came out of that. I left my harmonicas in Colorado. So it'll be sans harmonica. My lady was born in deep West Virginia, where the hills sing a mighty song, where the mountains tell tales
coal mines and whiskey, and the fiddles all cry till the dawn. Well, she flew from that place with the grace of an angel on the race towards the brightest light. In a dusty old bar in Barrington County, she danced into my life. She said, put one foot forward tonight, just give me your left hand and you take my right. And if you feel nervous, just set it aside and put one foot forward tonight. Well, we waltz through the country, we waltz through the field, and we waltzed right down I-95. We waltzed all the way to New York City, and it's trying to eat us alive. But we found a fresh basket to hold an old flame, which we pass back and forth with care. And if you look closely on a cold winter's night, you'll see us bobbing down Washington Square. We'll say, put one foot forward tonight, just give me your left hand and you take my right. And if you feel the sorrow, just set it aside and put one foot forward tonight. Be much of a dancer, I may stumble all over my shoes, but if you will oblige this clumsy false cowboy, well, I would trip my silly life away with you. And I'll say, put one foot forward tonight, I will give you my left hand if you give me your right. And if you feel foolish, just set it aside and put one foot forward tonight. Come on and put one foot forward tonight. Oh, put one foot forward tonight.
Oh, that was beautiful. And we had a question come in during, thank you so much. Oh, yeah. We had a question for you from Chris Merrill, who's on the call. Do the characters sing songs in this musical? And I want to correct that it's not really technically a musical, but do the characters sing songs in this musical, or is music employed as a sense of atmosphere? So I guess it's probably neither one of those, right? How would you describe it?
So we think of it as a play with music. The musician, my character, is kind of present all the time and acts almost like a Greek chorus. So in between segments of the play, there are musical interludes, songs with lyrics, that is more than just atmosphere, that actually brings you into the next section of the play. There are moments where the characters sing along. There are moments where we hope the audience will sing along. And then there is a song that is sung by one of the characters exclusively. There's also some underscoring, a little bit of incidental music here and there at particular points, probably I think 3 points, there's a little bit of underscoring. But it's definitely a different kind of show than we think of when we think of a show with music, or we think of musicals as something that where the music, you know, pushes the action forward and is from the first person perspective. And in this one, it's more of a way to breathe within the show.
Wow, that's good.
Where you can breathe, where you can take in a different way what is going to happen next.
That is excellent description, by the way. Breathing within the show. I really like that.
It's important to come up for air every now and then.
Yeah. And I think the show would be profoundly different without the music.
Definitely.
I think the music also allows us to release all that tension and that grief within the various scenes. Mm-hmm. The other question we have is, what was the outcome of the court case of the mine explosion? I don't think it's bad to give that away. This is really not a plot-driven play.
Yeah, no spoilers here. But the case went to court, and it was Don Blankenship, the one who owned Massey Mines, which owned the upper, which had taken over Upper Big Branch. And he was found. Oh, I don't know if I should. Yeah. He was found guilty of conspiracy to commit fraud. and to commit fraud against like mine safety procedures. He was fined $250,000 and sentenced to like a year in jail, which he didn't serve the whole thing. It's just a tiny, I mean, for someone who's a multi-millionaire, you know, and for someone whose responsibility it was to oversee this this mine, it was a negligible kind of outcome, which worked out pretty well for him. And then afterwards he got out of jail and released a little booklet that he sent to all the families about like how he was a victim of the courts.
He called himself a political prisoner. Essentially, we didn't give anything away because, as I said, this isn't really a plot-driven show, and of course anybody could find this out. It was very controversial, the verdict. Joe, what did you think of Boulder? You were here. Joe was here, by the way, to meet all the actors and to do a couple of house parties. Thank you if any of the hosts are on this call. But you had only been to Colorado once, right?
I was in Denver for a few nights working on we were passing through with a tour of a show that was written by Stephen King and John Mellencamp. and we did a couple nights in Denver. I never got up to Boulder. Colorado is beautiful. It's incredible. I've never really seen anything like it. I'm from Michigan originally. So, I mean, it's just green trees and hills. And then, you know, my time in New York, I've been here since 2004. Time in West Virginia, hills, trees, green. I forgot how flat Colorado is. I always just picture mountains everywhere. I was thinking like Colorado is all mountains, and it's really, and just like to like drive the prairie between Denver and Boulder, and just like, oh right, it is flat and there are mountains way up there. was delightfully surprising. You know, my expectations were, I didn't know what to expect, and Boulder seems absolutely lovely. I can't wait to come back and really explore. It sounds
and
like
you know Joe will be here for the obviously he's going to be here for the entire run. You're going to have many opportunities to meet Joe, and we're also planning other house parties and guest appearances from Joe as well. So let me know, text me. I'll give you my phone number if you want to text me. It's 773-456-1376, 773-456-1376, or you could just write me at Betsy if you want to be included in any of these. You'll meet him at the reception if you're at opening night. Joe, I wanted you to tell the great story about meeting your idol, Steve Earle. Of course, way before you were a glint in the eye of the playwrights and were called in to audition, you had admired Steve Earle. And then you walked into that audition room and tell us what happened.
Yeah, I walked in. I brought my long neck banjo, which is from the 60s, and I brought an old Kalamazoo brand acoustic guitar, which was from the late 30s. I walk in with that thing, and I see Steve and Jessica and Eric behind the table. And I mean, I'd seen Steve in the Wire, you know, and on Treme. I'd seen lots of footage of him. I'd never seen him live, and I'd been listening to him since I was like 15. So, I mean, hearing the voice. I walk in, I have this old guitar, and I smile, I say hi to everybody. I'm like, hey, Steve. And he looks at me and goes, I got that same guitar. It was great. It was a great first exchange to have. Because he's a guitar aficionado. He has a huge collection of guitars. He's incredible knowledge of guitars.
And you later went to his condo and he showed you his collection, didn't he?
He showed me his New York collection. He has a whole house full of them in Nashville. But yeah, he took me one day. It was going into tech. We were about to, we had 3 hours for our sound check, and we were done in like 15 minutes. And he's like, what are you doing? I'm like, I don't know. I'm just going to walk around. And we were in the village, and he was just like, you want to come over to my place and just check out some guitars? I'm like, yeah, absolutely. We walked back, and he had probably had 30 different instruments there. And just one by one, he just opened the case. This is 1925 Martin, blah, 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 you know, and just hearing him and the stories that he had about every one of them, you know, who he got them from, who built it, how much it was worth, what he played it on. I mean, it was just incredible. It was so cool. And I mean, from that moment where I kind of came into the audition room, it just felt like let's just get to work. You know, I played it in a weird, I was playing them in kind of like a weird tuning, because all I had to listen to learn the songs were a couple of like home recordings that he had sent me through the stage management. And I was just trying to, like, there was no instructions or no sheet music or anything. So I'm trying to figure this stuff out. He capos things really weird. You know, and we're just like talking about tunings and where to capo things and what his style is. And like from the top, it just felt like, all right, we're just colleagues now. We're colleagues. We're gonna work together. It was really cool. And then from then on, it was, you know, he called me in when they were doing the Audible recordings. He called me to come down to the studio, to Electric Lady Studios, and just kind of remind what keys things were in, or just like how things were arranged. He had me assist him as musical director, you know, and take notes and be the kind of I guess the kind of like musical memory of the show. And so it was, you know, we shared a dressing room. It was just one of those moments where you meet somebody that you've admired for a long time, and just listen, you know. There's a lot of listening.
I want to thank you so much for coming, but I want to end on a song, and I wanted you to pick it. Is there a song in Coal Country that is your favorite? I know that's tough, because I think you like them all.
I don't know. I don't know if there's a favorite. I think the first one that I'd ever heard was actually not from Coal Country at all.
Oh,
he wrote,
okay.
He wrote The Mountain with when he did a bluegrass album with the Del McCoury band. This is probably 1997 or so. It was right after I first heard him in 95 with his song that he did on the Dead Man Walking album, and then got his album Train Coming, which is an all acoustic album. He had been a rocker, kind of a rocker before that. Then he did this bluegrass, purely bluegrass album with the Del McCoury band, amazing bluegrass band, but he did The Mountain on that one. So that was the first song I'd heard. And then the people just knew it and liked it so much that it fit into Coal Country, even though it's about mountaintop removal, coal removal rather than underground coal, you know, but, or part of it is anyway.
Let's hear it.
I'm gonna do The Mountain just cause that was the first one. That was an early one. It's a really great tune for what we're doing.
Well, thank you. I want to thank you before the end of your song. Thank you for coming. I want to remind everyone that Joe will be here all the way through November 19th, and you'll have plenty of chances to meet him. He's an amazing guy, as you can tell. Thanks, Joe, and can't wait to hear this.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. I'm really excited to come up. I'm excited to be a part of it. I was born on this mountain a long time ago. For they knocked down the timber and stripped mine to coal. When you rose in the morning, before it was light, went down in that dark hole, come back up at night. I was born on this mountain, this mountain's my home, and she holds me and keeps me from worry and woe. Well, they took everything that she gave, now they're gone. But I'll die on this mountain, this mountain's my home. I was young on this mountain, now I'm old. And I knew every holler, every cool swimming hole. Till one night I lay down and I woke up to find that my childhood was over. I went down in the mine. I was born on this mountain, this mountain's my home, and she holds me and keeps me from worry and woe. Well, they took everything that she gave, now they're gone, but I'll die on this mountain, this mountain's my home. There's a hole in this mountain, it's dark and it's deep. God only knows all the secrets it keeps.
There's a chill in the air only miners can feel. Ghosts in the tunnel, the company sealed.
Okay, well, Joe Jung, thank you so much. We welcome you with open arms to Boulder. Joe is arriving on Friday evening and hitting the ground running with the cast who will be ready for him. And I can't wait to see all of you. Thank you for coming tonight. Thank you again, Joe. And I will see you at the dairy. Bye, everyone.